former restaurant worker and an amazing high school student who is an intern with the worker center and who partook in the process of sitting down with workers and conducting their surveys. So, Pearl, if you want to come up. Forgive me, I am sick, but I really wanted to be here, so I might be a little shaky. Okay, I'm just going to read something that I wrote up last week in response to a lot of the media that we're talking about and that brought us here together today. As an intern and worker center with the Pioneer Valley Worker Center, since September 2014, I have spoken at length with dozens of restaurant workers. The center recently released a study based on 235 surveys, and since then, many people have attempted to discredit the report by claiming that it does not reflect the climate in Northampton. And yet, 235 workers chose to participate in this study. These are the people that serve your coffee, cook your dinners, and mop up after you leave. I am one of those people. When I was 16, working in Northampton Food Service, my coworkers sexually harassed me repeatedly. I first went to my manager, who was silent. I then went to my boss, who covered it up. And for 7 months afterwards, I was forced to work with this man every Thursday night. I'm sharing my story because 235 other workers shared theirs. One in four restaurant workers in Northampton have experienced sexual harassment while on the job. One in four. Recent media coverage has conflated workplace and street harassment, which cannot be put in the same category. Like me, many workers are forced to interact with their harassers every day. The power dynamic between a worker and an employer cannot be ignored. My employer took advantage of his power position and chose to do nothing because he did not risk a consequence. As a white woman with US citizenship, I face fewer risks for speaking out, but undocumented women and women of color face an entirely different set of obstacles than I do. So shaking it off is not an option for many women, especially when speaking out could jeopardize their job. Many in the restaurant industry rely on that enforced silence to maintain their profits. There must be a different way. This is our opportunity to think about the hundreds of workers in Northampton who contribute to our lives, whether they serve you or work for you. If you're a restaurant employer that treats your employees justly, then you have nothing to fear. Over 200 workers put forward their stories to make change. I suggest that as a community, we listen. Thank you. Introduce our next restaurant worker who is a current restaurant worker. His name is Jonathan, and he's going to be sharing his experiences.
Hi everyone, thank you for coming. I just want to let you know how he's working a restaurant and a special couple restaurant. I don't want to say any name specific, you know, like in Northampton, because I don't want to be more there, you know. So I just wanna say something right. So, but I think was very a little difficult for me to explain everything. So that's what my friend translate for you. So, yeah.
We want to begin with everyone having, for everyone to have equality.
Seguimos en una lucha para todos los trabajadores en Northampton para tener una igualdad y no una diferencia de denominarla como un racismo.
We're in a struggle to obtain equality here in Northampton and to address the differences or racist inequalities.
Creo que todos los que nos tomamos este tiempo de estar aquí al frente, creo que es algo de gran de gran valor. No cualquiera puede estar aquí. Yo soy uno de ellos que a la misma vez tengo miedo y nervios de que pueda pasar algo.
I want to say that it takes a lot of courage, a lot of valor for the people who are standing here to be with you. I personally have a lot of nerves. I'm anxious that something could happen.
So, solamente quiero, sé que el tiempo no nos ajusta para hablar y entrar en tema específicamente, pero quiero darle las gracias a todos por venir y hacer valer nuestra voz y pues necesitar de su apoyo.
I know that we don't have a lot of time to get into specific details, but I want to thank everyone who came here today for showing your support and demonstrating that the voices of workers matter.
So una vez más, muchas gracias a todos, y pedirles una vez más de su apoyo y seguir adelante, que todo esto se vuelva una realidad y no un desánimo.
So again, I want to thank everyone for coming here, and I hope that the efforts of our struggle become a reality and not a disappointment.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Ninge. First, I want to thank you, Rose, and Body Worker Center gave me this opportunity to be here. I'm a restaurant worker, and I have been working in a restaurant for over 14 years. I worked in about 15 different restaurants in 6 different states, as south as West Virginia, as north as Massachusetts. So here I want to share 3 examples of my 14 years restaurant life. My first job was in New Jersey. I was a kitchen helper. What I did is do all the dirty and heavy works. I worked from 11 to 11 on weekday, and 11 to 12 on weekend. 6 days a week, 74 hours a week. And I make $1,300 a month, which is $4 per hour. My previous job was in Connecticut. I was a cashier. I worked from 11 to 10 on my weekday and 11 to 11 on my weekend, 68 hours a week. And I made $2,200, which was $7.48. My current job's here in Northampton. I'm a sushi chef. I work 48 hours a week, and I make around $2,100 a month, which is $9.38. So in 14 years, from $4 per hour to $9.38. It took me 14 years to get that. And in fact, in 14 years, there's no like one single day that I ever make minimum wage. And it's not only me. People who I know, my friends, my coworkers who work in a restaurant, most of them don't make minimum wage. And besides that, we don't get overtime pay. We don't get sick pay. We don't get sick days. We don't get vacation days. We don't have health insurance. We don't get these benefits, not because we don't deserve them, but because some of the restaurant owners don't want to follow the law. It is a problem. I like to go out to eat in a restaurant where its workers can be treated well. A restaurant where its worker can make at least minimum wage. A restaurant where its workers can pay their rent. a restaurant where its worker can go to hospital without worrying about the medical bill when they got cut or got burned. A restaurant where its worker not only can put the food on the table for a customer, but put the food on their own tables. And I believe each one of you here agree with me on this. It is my dream that all the restaurant workers can make at least minimum wage. All the restaurant workers can get the benefits. These are our rights. We work hard and we deserve that. However, without your support, my dream will not come true. So thank you all for listening. Thank you.
That was really amazing and powerful. Thank you again. I'd like to invite Abel to come and speak. Abel is also a restaurant worker in town.
Hi everyone, my name is Abelardo Salinas. She's gonna share some part of my story about the restaurant worker. I came to the United States like 10 years ago when I just got 16 years old, and I started working like food service, and I worked 6 days a week and probably 26 days a month, and I got only $1,300 for payment. At that time I was a little boy for 16 years, and so I had to work all week. And then like when I got 17, I started working in the kitchen to chop the vegetables in the dishwasher, and I got the same pay. Well, I got so much discrimination because I am undocumented, and the place that when I went working it was a hotel, and there is all a lot of people, they don't like the undocumented people, the immigrant. And then I'm all the time in isolation for the customers to call me, get out in this country, which is thing make me feel very bad. And sometimes I see the kids working with the parents, reminding my parents that for the economy situation in my country make me to decide to come to the United States. And until now, and the only thing I do every single day is to say thank you, my God, to let me continue with the job. But for the same things, thanks to God, I got a better job now. But I had to work the same amount of hours, but a little better pay. So now I work 6 days a week, but I got $11 by hours plus the tips. And it's not hard, it's not easy to be the head chef or the chef. Sometimes I have pressure for the customers, sometimes for the owner, when something is wrong, and I understand that. But the thing that I want to ask you guys to do me a favor, help us with the worker center to someday getting through this dream, the one we got all of us right here in the front, so everybody can have some benefit, like how my friend Lincoln said. Because like 3 years ago, I got surgery for pending, and I was working in the restaurant when I got some hurt in my stomach, and then I had to go to the hospital. I got the surgery, I don't got insurance cover until after 15 days I got out from the hospital. I got one bill, which is $24,400. So, excuse me. The things get changed year by year, but because we try to find a way how we can get better. It's not because we the owner or someone else out helping us. We keep working the same hours, but the owner don't give the cover insurance. We don't have the my other coworker, they don't have a minimum pay. We have to start like $8 by hours to work 70 hours, 80 hours a week. Sometimes I had to work 14 to 15 hours by day, from 7:30 to 11 o'clock in the night. But sometimes I had to work 8 o'clock in the morning to 12 o'clock in the midnight, which is not easy. And just you guys thinking a little bit about it, to be little kids to work that much the hours. You guys have a kid, like son or daughter, 17 or 18 years old. How you guys can feel to see your kids be working that long hours with little pay? It's not fair for the coworker. It's not because we are the document or just we don't have the citizen. We can work like anyone. Everybody have feelings. Everybody have think this probably different way than this. Some of the people from here think. But well, I would like to see you guys could do a favor, help us to someday make this dream it true. Thank you.
So I'd like to introduce Bess. Bess is a server in town. She is also an intern at the center and has played such an amazing role again. I know I keep saying that, but they're just really amazing people, and their level of compassion is just really humbling. So I'd like to invite Bess up.
Hi everyone. I want to thank again everyone who's on stage sharing their stories. I know how hard it is. I'm also feeling nervous, especially for those of you who risk a lot being here today and to stand up on the stage and have people take photos of you and give your names. That's really, really brave. So I'm a server in Northampton. And I want to speak today for a lot of my coworkers who could not come because, as other people have said before, like other restaurant workers in Northampton, a lot of my coworkers work 12-hour days, 6 days a week, so most of them are at work right now and we're not able to make it. And also, for my coworkers who are in vulnerable positions to share their stories because they're at risk of either losing their job or worse, risk of deportation. So a little bit about myself. I grew up in this area, and I grew up going to a lot of the restaurants here, including the one that I work at and the one that I used to work at. I'm a college student, I'm a Smith student, and I've been working in restaurants for about 3 years in Northampton. When I started working in restaurants in Northampton, I realized that Northampton keeps a really good secret, which is that behind the kitchen doors, most of the workers are undocumented, and they're working under conditions that anyone who is a white US citizen who grew up in Northampton, like me, would find extremely exploitative and not be able to believe exist. So just one example, one of my coworkers now is a dishwasher at the restaurant where I work. He's 19 years old, he doesn't speak any English. He makes around $5.50 an hour. When I talked to him, I did a survey with him that was included in the 235 surveys, and when I asked him, do you know what the minimum wage is? He said no, and I told him it was $10 an hour, which is almost twice as much as what he's making right now. In addition, he is extremely isolated, as many of my coworkers are. I have some coworkers who have been working 5-10 more years in the restaurant and barely know the city, partly because they don't speak English, but also because the way that restaurants are set up structurally, it keeps people invisible, which is the reason why we don't see all of the undocumented people that live in this town day to day on the streets. So even for me, wages have been stolen, and I am someone who grew up in this town. I make tips at the restaurant where I work, but I do not receive a paycheck. When I talked to my boss about it, she told me that it's because that money goes to taxes on tips, which I know is not true. I tell these stories because restaurant workers' voices have been missing from a lot of the recent conversations since we have released the white paper and explained our ideas for the wage theft ordinance. Mostly this is because restaurant workers have not been able to express themselves anonymously. In addition, the reason why I don't give the name of the restaurant where I work now is because although I believe that my bosses are at fault for breaking wage laws, I want to show that this is a systemic issue. That it's not only my restaurant where this is happening, but restaurants in Northampton and throughout the rest of the country. And as Lin Gang explained, this isn't just happening in Massachusetts. Even still though, I think it's important to know that as a community that is so well known as progressive, this is happening here, and we are not a special bubble, as everyone keeps saying. Northampton is not a bubble. We are completely within this exploitive system. And I want to especially speak to all of you who are probably customers and have eaten. I know some of you, I recognize some of you as customers who I've served. I think it's really important that you come out of this and tell other customers about what you heard today. Also, it's important to remember that if you identify as someone who is progressive, who is an activist, as a lot of people in this town do, you can't go to restaurants without thinking about these things or talking, at least talking to the workers you interact with and ask them, you know, truly ask them, how are you? How is your day? How is work, without being too pushy. I think also it's important to talk to bosses about their restaurant practices. As customers, you are the ones who support their businesses. You have a voice to be able to talk to bosses, and that is the power you have. So I want to end with a question. As a progressive community, are we going to turn a blind eye to exploitation in the places we eat? Are we going to just focus on how ethical our food is, or are we going to focus on how ethical the practices are within the restaurants? Are we going to stand up? Are we going to use our collective power to stand up for Northampton restaurant workers? I hope the answer is yes. Thank you.
I hope you guys like it, all right? We try to do the best what we can.
Vestida de color de rosa como flor hermosa te acercaste a mí luciendo tu sutil encanto con tu cuerpo santo te abrazaste a mí recuerdo con amor profundo cuando me decía que te canté Te jugarás y te abrazarás cuando te cante. Vestida de color de rosa, vestida de color de rosa, bonita como caprichosa, como mariposa en el agua azul. Vestida de color de rosa, vestida de color de rosa, te quiero porque tienes cosas, muchas, muchas cosas, mucho tienes tú.
Tus ojos, ojitos traviesos han quedado impresos en esta canción. Te quiero por 30 besos para llevar los besos en mi corazón. Te quiero con amor profundo, no hay
Vestida de color de rosa,
bonita como caprichosa, como mariposa en el agua azul.
Vestida de color de rosa, vestida de color de rosa, te quiero porque tienes cosas, muchas, muchas cosas, mucho tienes tú.
I'd like to invite Nick up, who is a restaurant worker in town at a really popular venue.
Okay. Hi, my name is Nick Belluccio. I'm currently finishing my senior year at Hampshire College, and as of last September, have been an employee at Local Burger in Northampton. I was asked by a member of the Northampton Worker Center to speak to you all briefly about my experiences working at a restaurant in the area. I'm aware that recently articles were written in attempts to highlight the restaurant environment, yet in all honesty failed to incorporate a number of testimonies from a number of employees, and have also skewed the real negative realities of working in this industry. Personally, I can say nothing but nice things about the management at Local. They treat myself and every employee with kindness and respect, help when need be, and to the best of my knowledge, abide by all fair and legal practices of running a restaurant. I, like any other front of house employee, live off tips, and I'm constantly grateful for what customers leave us, let alone the busyness of the restaurant as a whole. However, I take all of these things for granted, because as I'm well aware, a lot of the practices I mentioned are, more often than not, experienced everywhere by other restaurant employees in the area. In some cases, and as witnessed at a recent City Hall meeting, the practice of wage theft continues to persist, whether by stealing workers' tips, underpaying their employees, or in some cases, not paying them at all. While I was asked to say how Local is not one of these restaurants, I can't stress enough that not every restaurant runs in this way. While I'm pleased that light is being shed on these prevalent issues, there's still a lot of work to be done in not only giving a voice to the workers who aren't or can't be heard, but also rectifying the malpractices that continue at a constant rate in this industry. Thanks.
So we're going to hear from another group of folks. I'd like to invite Jocelyn Jones up. She's a labor lawyer, and she also used to work at the Attorney General's office. So she has a lot of experience with dealing with issues of workplace.
Okay. I'm also a resident of Northampton, and I work at the law firm Siegel Reutemann, which is in Boston, but I work from Northampton. And I have to say first to the worker who just spoke, thank God the Local is a good employer, because my sons eat there all the time. What I really wanted to communicate to everyone today is, as has been mentioned before, this is not about Northampton. This is an incredibly systemic problem across the country and across Massachusetts. I was the deputy chief of the Fair Labor Division for the past 8.5 years. Until about 4 months ago, and the restaurant industry has been on the priority list of the Attorney General's office for many, many, many of those years. And I was, before being Deputy Chief, an Assistant Attorney General doing the actual cases, and time after time, it was a restaurant worker coming in, whether that restaurant worker came in with a worker center or by him or herself. There were others behind him or her that were being exploited the same way. So having the guts to come forward, as you folks have, is a really important part of getting the truth out. And having a community like Northampton, as was mentioned before, makes this an issue that can be tackled. Because it's really getting people behind, people who have strong progressive values, behind people who need, who are in need and who need the protections that the law provides them. I have a lot of faith in the city government here. I'm new, I've been here for 4 years. I feel like I just moved here yesterday in some ways, but I had worked closely with Mayor Walsh in the city of Boston around the wage ordinance that they put in into play there. And I think that if the city of Boston, which has enormous amount of restaurants, possibly on the same proportion per capita as Northampton, but if they can put into play a wage ordinance that deals with leveraging the city's power to live by its own morals and to hold the contractors that it deals with by high standards and to afford the privilege of having a license from the city to those who actually deserve them, we can do that here. I also wanted to underscore the point that, as was just mentioned, this is not just an issue about justice to workers. there are many important, upstanding, great restaurants and cafes and coffee shops throughout Northampton that are being undercut day after day because of cheating competitors. Those who are paying workers off the clock, not reporting payroll, not paying wages, stealing tips, those are all means of undercutting their competition and making more money on the backs of the workers and on the backs of the community. They're not paying taxes the way they're supposed to be paying into the tax base here. And it's time for them to not have a free ride anymore. So it's not just about justice for the workers, although that in all of our hearts is what matters the most. It's about a level playing field for those law-abiding businesses in town. And that is one of the lessons that I learned at the Attorney General's office over many years, is that the laws are in place to protect people, but the employers are people too, and good restaurants that are hiring people, treating them justly, and providing employment is important too. So I asked the upstanding restaurants in Northampton to get behind this effort and to come forward and ask what they can do to help, and work with the government, work with the Pioneer Valley Worker Center to put together an ordinance that makes sense and that gets this done. So thanks for listening.
Also wanted to acknowledge that we have one city council member present, Maureen Carney, so let's just give her a round of applause. And Maureen has played a really supportive and active role in wanting to bring this issue to city council so this would protect all workers in our city, regardless of your industry, regardless of your legal status. And so for that reason, I want to invite up Charlie Payne from the Carpenters Union to speak to us about the realities that carpenter workers face and how this wage theft ordinance would also protect them from wage theft.
Okay, thank you all for coming, and thank you for the privilege of being able to talk to you tonight. I'm a little nervous, but this is really important to me. We all live in a bubble, and we see what's around us. And I'm a construction guy, banging nails for 25 years. And I became an organizer a year ago. And what I saw on job sites really hit close to my heart. I don't like seeing people exploited, and I don't like the way people are going about doing it. So what I'd like to explain to you tonight, and you can draw some parallels to the restaurant workers, what the underground economy and misclassifying means to construction. And who misclassifying hurts, and the taxpayers, the insurance companies, right down to the everyday citizen. And it raises costs for everybody in the every citizen across the board. That's why we should care about it. It hurts us personally. We don't even know it. First of all, misclassifying people on a construction job will be, okay, you work for me, but you're an independent contractor. I'm no longer your employer. I'm just going to pay you a flat rate. And by the way, you don't have insurance. You don't have workers' comp. And I save 28 to 35%. My labor costs by doing that to somebody. Now, when you get a decent restaurant or a decent contractor and they try to compete against somebody who's doing that, it's not fair. They can't do it. It makes the good people bad because they have to cheat to try to compete. And the people that are exploited and are hurt the most are always the people that are the most vulnerable. I don't like going on a job site seeing a guy who's afraid to talk to me, because his boss will tell him, I'll call immigration if I see you talking to that union rep. It's not right. We have to ask ourselves, do we want people treated like this in our community? Northampton is probably one of the few communities that has the courage to do something about this. There's a lot of people don't care, because you go in the back door of the restaurant, the construction worker is invisible too. He slides in, he starts at 6 in the morning, nobody wants to see him. I'm sorry, I'm nervous.
I agree.
I'm a little passionate. So we have a temporary nature, our jobs. You know, you're here for 6 months and then you're gone. So people don't really, you don't get to know people. A lot of these guys that come to these construction jobs, they eat in their car. They don't, you know, you don't see them at the coffee shop in the morning. They come in, they do their job. 1 in 4 of these people is misclassified. That means that they're not paying taxes. There's no insurance, all that stuff on that income. What that works in the construction, and I don't know the numbers for the restaurant workers, but across the country, that's about $2 trillion in unreported income. That translates to about between $400 and $600 billion in unpaid income taxes. That's money that's taken away from building schools, bridges, any kind of public infrastructure. Never mind what it does to state aid to your towns and cities. One other thing, I'd like to bring this a little closer to Northampton. We have a job, Christopher Heights Development, that was done. I think it's called Hospital Hill. I visited that job with another representative from the Carpenters Union. We found 4 gentlemen that we knew, and they told us they were getting paid cash on that job. And the reason that they were willing to tell us that is because the gentleman I work with helped them a few years ago on a job where the contractor refused to pay them for time that they had already worked for. And they were, some of them guys were illegal, and the boss is not above telling them, if you tell on me, I'm going to immigration. That's wrong. Someone does the work, you give them the fair pay. What brings us a little bit closer to home too is when we did a little more investigation, Christopher Heights got a tax break of $213,000 over a 15-year period. That's like bringing someone to your house for dinner and having them leave with your dog. That's just wrong. And the developer made the money, the contractor made the money, but he's lighting the candle at both ends and he's stealing from everybody, the worker, the citizen. Everybody's being taken advantage of, and we really need to just crack down on it. We're not asking you to do anything above and beyond. Just do what's already legal and right. And I'd like to thank you for listening to me tonight, and I hope you have a better understanding of what misclassification means to the construction worker, and you can see some of the parallels and why we're here to support the restaurant workers. Thank you.
As many of you know, the Haymarket started paying its workers $15 an hour in support for the 15 minimum wage. So, Peter, if you'd like to come up.
Well, thank you for having me. Inviting me to speak, I appreciate that. I've been working in Northampton for 35 years in the restaurant industry. And when my brother and I reopened the cafe 25 years ago, it was really with the intention of trying to do something which was counter to the status quo in our experiences of the previous 10 years working in the restaurant industry, my brother Moore. And we felt like we had reached certain goals, specifically in the way that we were interacting with the staff and trying to create a positive relationship. But I always felt like we were hitting certain ceilings as far as pay was concerned. And really, it was really only in the last 2 years that I felt very inspired by the $15 an hour campaign out on the West Coast and tried to figure out how we could do that as well. And I think it's important for restaurant owners to really grapple with rethinking structurally their pay scales. And I've been very moved to hear the people speak today. I worked with a lot of Latin Americans, obviously, in the restaurant industry in my career, and it's just sometimes shocking, right, the experiences. And but I feel like this is just the beginning. These are like the gross manifestations of the restaurant industry. I think what we really need to be shooting for is obviously addressing these issues that you've been bringing up, but also to really be pushing for something larger and sooner, right? Not $12 an hour by 2022. Like, we need to get paid more now, you know what I mean? People are working hard, we need to get paid more. I feel like it's only been since November since we switched our pay scale, and to be clear, we're paying $14 an hour right now, but we've committed to paying $15 starting this fall, $16 next fall, and $17 by 2018, sort of in the same rhythm. But also, something which I would really encourage other employers to do is to think about the sub-minimum wage, which is what wait staff are getting paid now. And I feel like it's really made a more of a consistent livelihood for the people at the cafe, because we don't accept tips anymore anywhere in the cafe. And it feels calmer, and I think it's created a much more positive relationship in regards to the front of the house and the back of the house. And I would really encourage other restaurants to consider the no tipping policy and striving to pay a living wage for all of their staff. I just want to thank you all for coming tonight. It's very encouraging to see so many people here in a town that I'm really grew up in and feel so fondly of, and to see other people with the same hopes for the town is very special. Thank you. Have a nice evening.
I'd like to invite up, I'm sorry if I mispronounced it, Shamila Ruiz? Oh, did I mispronounce it? Okay, Shamila. From the Restaurant Opportunity Center. For folks who don't know, ROC is a nationwide organization that does amazing work to improve and obtain the rights of restaurant workers. So come.
Hi everybody, thank you for having me tonight. Again, my name is Shamila. I'm an organizer with the Restaurant Opportunity Center here in New England. We are a local chapter of a national nonprofit worker center, like the Pioneer Valley Worker Center, that does great work to improve the conditions of restaurant workers. I am a former restaurant worker. I got involved with the organization through our national RAISE coordinator. We have a RAISE program. It's an acronym for Restaurants Advancing Industry Standards of Employment. Peter at the Haymarket Cafe is a participating member, and he's doing great work through that program. We're eager to have partners in the conversation that are really practicing these high road practices as opposed to taking the low road, which is what many employers have done historically. Since the creation of the minimum wage almost a century ago, federal law has mandated that tipped workers be paid them less than everyone else. That's wrong, and it's time that we fix it. I also want to take a minute to congratulate our partners at the Pioneer Valley Worker Center for the amazing work that they've done in this research and really bringing to light the conversation about the subminimum tipped wage and why it's an issue in our country. It's a conversation that hasn't been had, and with these national conversations happening in the Fight for 15, we want to make sure that restaurant workers have a seat at the table and aren't just serving it, right? They have been historically subject to these practices that go back to slavery. The institution of the subminimum wage actually dates back. Our organization has published numerous books and reports on this. And the tipped minimum wage is economic injustice. Given that most of the workers in America are paid just $2.13, that's the federal minimum wage, an hour, and that most are women of color, it's clearly racial injustice too. Just some figures for you guys. Nearly 70% of tipped restaurant workers are women across the country, 40% of whom are mothers. The subminimum wage for tipped workers is in effect legislated pay inequity for predominantly female workforce, and this perpetuates the gender pay gap. So we really feel that eliminating the subminimum wage would go across many barriers, not just gender, but also race, and really help to stabilize these economic injustices. There's right now 7 other states that have eliminated the subminimum tipped wage, and the restaurant industries there are thriving, including the entire West Coast, California, Oregon, Nevada. They have 1 fair wage for everyone. It really helps to bridge the gap between the back of the house and the front of the house workers. Poverty is lower, restaurant receipts are higher, menu prices are not higher, and tipping is even better. 1 fair wage is a win-win for everybody. So I just wanted to go ahead and say thank you guys so much, and thank you to the workers for presenting their stories. You guys are an inspiration. It's why we do the work that we do. Thanks, guys.
So we have one more speaker, but before we transition to hear from them, I just want to say that we have a petition that's circulating, and that petition is calling on City Council to pass the Northampton Wage Theft Ordinance, so if you could sign that. And if everyone signed it, we have copies online as well that you can sign, and also some promotion, like our Facebook page, so you can get more updates and information about what we're doing. And so I'd like to pass the mic to John from Jobs with Justice.
As many of you know, because I see a lot of people who've been behind Jobs with Justice over the years, Jobs with Justice is a coalition. It organizes solidarity among approximately 80 members in Western Mass, all organizations. And in the long history, a couple decades of this organization, we've never really done direct organizing. And someone in this room brought the vision of the Pioneer Valley Workers Center. And I want to make sure that we thank Rose Bookbinder. Woo-hoo! Many of our members of our board are here, many of the representatives of our coalition partners. Did you ever imagine 2 years ago when we launched this thing as a project within the organization that we would be on the verge not just of a freestanding worker center fighting the battles up and down the food chain, but we'd be here today with an organization of workers standing up for themselves? Because what we are facing in the United States today is the difference between sitting on your ass and standing up for your rights. We're at that point, and we see it in the politics, and we see it in the economics, and we see it in the internationalism. We're at that point where every individual faces that choice, that decision. We hope that by your support for the Workers' Center, and for this ordinance, and for the bigger picture of economic and social justice, your activism, we're going to get to a point where the thing that determines wages, the thing that determines the quality of life in America, is the working people and not the employers. Thank you.
So we have a few more minutes, and I thought that we could hear from other restaurant workers, if you guys came, if you're not, you know, working. We could hear from you guys, and we could also take some questions. And I also just kind of wanted to intervene really quickly of why I do this work. I was undocumented for 20 years. That was up until about, 3 years ago that I finally obtained a green card. My parents worked in restaurants. That was the first job that my dad had. My mom mainly worked as a domestic worker. And doing this work with the Workers Center, I have met a lot of undocumented workers, and I think it's important to ask the question of, why are they here? Why are we here? Why was my family forced to come here? And one of the workers who came into our office today to learn about his rights, he is a man from Honduras, and he is fleeing the violence that due to the U.S.-backed military coup in 2009. So we need to put that into perspective, that the U.S. economic policies are forcing immigrants to come to the United States. And by those standards, he is a refugee. So these aren't just, we can call them undocumented workers, but they're also refugees who are fleeing from violence that our government has directly supported. Other people who are from El Salvador are also fleeing from the legacies of a civil war that the United States funded with $3 billion. So we need to put that into perspective and really ask ourselves, we can laugh at Donald Trump and say the way that he talks about Syrian refugees, but how are we going to be treating the Latin American refugees who cook our food? So I just wanted to insert that. I also study history, so I like to get the big picture involved.